Well, we've got a lot to cover this evening, and it's going to be an exciting evening for everybody. I'm John Toole, if you don't know who I am. I'm the Executive Director and CEO of the Computer Museum History Center. It's really an exciting time for us. Let me just take a couple of minutes to tell you a little bit who we are, because our mission is really to preserve the artifacts and stories in the information age. We've got a 15-year rich history from beginning in Boston. The artifacts moved here, and I hope you all can join us afterwards for a reception we're having over in our visible storage area. This is an old warehouse that we've converted into something I think you'll really find exciting and interesting from the museum side. We take our mission seriously. We're putting in a new building in 3 to 5 years. We're part and parcel with partners with NASA Ames, as you probably could guess being here. But the 200-acre research park that they're putting together with universities, Lockheed Martin, and commercial enterprises, plus a couple of museums. And we're one of those museums on a 3-acre tract of land. So we're in the process of fundraising and putting together things for our new building to be our permanent home. We have a very strong lecture program, and I welcome you all to our first lecture of the fall season. And Steve Roberts is a wonderful person to kick it off. Just to give you an idea, and there's literature out back, I really openly welcome everyone to ask me any questions you may have. Our chairman of the board, Len Schustick. Len, just so they know who you are, please ask Len any questions or any one of us. Many of the members are also here today. Our next three lectures are also going to be interesting ones. Richard Grimsdale from the University of Sussex will be here on September 28th, right here in this building. He had a very distinguished career in a lot of different ways and is famous for his transistor computer while he was at the University of Manchester. Then we go with Rich Tennant, who you may or may not know, but he was a cartoonist of the Fifth Wave. This was the guy who, you know, I would always get up and say, what is the next thing he's got? Well, he's actually agreed to look at computer history through the eyes of a cartoonist. So we do some interesting things in addition to the preservation of all those stories and things that we talked about. And I think you'll find this very, very interesting to come down the pike. And on November 8th, Fran Allen from IBM, who'd been with IBM since 1957, is a compiler researcher for Stretch Harvest and the ASC, IBM fellow, and done a lot of seminal work in compilers and software. So I think you're going to see a lot of really rich computer history. You'll see the opportunity to be upfront and personal with a lot of different things. And also, I think we're going to have a good time because we're going to make this a real showcase for computer history as we go forward for the next 3 to 5 years in our new building and part of the NASA Research Park. So get your name on the list, and we'd be glad to do it. And by the way, if you drop your card in that little box, we're going to raffle off one of Steve's books over at the reception this evening. Well, I don't want to take a lot of your time, so let me just give you a couple sound bites with Steve. I mean, here's a guy that talk about stories. Boy, can he put stories together about computing. You know, most of us go and they see you build a computer and you go to it, right? Well, Steve's dream, and the thing is, this passion for life, passion for living, is really so prevalent with Steve and Natasha, his partner who's done so much. But to take computing to the people and go across the country over and over, I don't know, 17,000 or 20,000 or 24,000, they logged miles. They were talking about their cat Java today, and they logged the number of miles that the cat has actually traveled. And this is the mechanism by which Steve kind of determines, you know, success or failure. No, I'm just kidding, Steve. So he's got so many stories from the times, you know, I guess you reported, you know, there were Maryland inmates to the time that if you saw this little beast up here, the behemoth is a real mouthful, and other things that I'm going to let him explain. Going 60 miles an hour down a highway, what would you do? Well, from his earlier book, at least one person kind of went into a wall or a pole somewhere. So there's a lot of great stories about computing, but the technology here is phenomenal as well. Don't underestimate, and you're going to get this wonder perspective from Steve Roberts. And Steve, welcome, and it's a real pleasure to have you here. Thanks so much.
Wow, this is a real pleasure.
We have audio?
Yeah, there it is. This is kind of a major moment in my life, actually. I've lived with this thing for something like 17 years now in various forms, from the early days back in Ohio in 83 to, you know, one dragging it around the country to do speaking engagements. This bike has been a very large part of my life. And one thing John didn't say is that this is a really big event that's happening right now, because the Computer Museum History Center is now Behemoth's official new home. For the last few years, we've been working on its successor, which is called the Microship, which I'll tell you about and actually show you. It's over at the reception. And the bike is going to stay right here and join all sorts of other amazing artifacts that are over in that building that we're going to be in. So, thanks. It's quite fitting. It's a Silicon Valley thing. Well, I got to give you a little history on this, because this didn't just spring fully formed into existence. There's a lot of components here, including a lot of brilliant technical input from some of the people in this room. In 1983, I was turning 30. I was living in a house in suburbia in Columbus, Ohio. And, you know, Columbus inspires long-distance travel. But there was actually more to it than that, because part of it is just this sort of change in life that was going on. All through my early years of being in high school and being a hobbyist through the 1970s, where I built an 8008 system in 74 and so on, I was always driven by passion. Science fairs, technology, new toys, gizmology. I'd stay up all night just doing stuff because it was just intrinsically cool. And I started finding more and more, as I turned my hobby into a business, that it ruined the hobby, which is a very familiar story to a lot of people. And in 1983, I was living in Columbus and found myself in this house in suburbia doing things that I didn't much enjoy anymore, trying to pay for things I really didn't want after all. Like, the American dream. That's a good definition of it, concise. I started thinking about, well, what happened to the passions? What is success? What's security? These are fundamental issues. Well, I realized that success is, it's the ratio, it's sort of like all of this stuff is the ratio of all you put out to all you get back. And this takes a lot of forms. It's not just the accumulation of wealth. And so that was one fundamental issue. Another one was the realization that passion has got to be the bottom line. And that's what had been missing. So I sat down one day and just listed my passions. And they were the obvious things like travel and adventure and computers, technology, romance, tinkering with electronics and gizmos, bicycling, publishing, movement, change, growth, learning. Ranging from neat little gizmology stuff to the sort of philosophical quest kinds of things. So the obvious solution was simply to sell my house in suburbia, move to the networks, wander around the country riding full-time for a living while bicycling. So I did, and much to the horror of my parents and girlfriend. And my mother's first reaction when it was like I couldn't give them impending change. It had to be a fait accompli. So I didn't want to tell them that I was going to sell my house in suburbia, because they had decided that I had finally settled down and that everything was now going to be okay, and maybe I'd even get a job eventually. So I just sort of waited, built the whole bike, got ready to go, and then about a week before departure, just sent them this article called Steve Roberts Computing Across America in the CompuServe magazine. And about 2 days afterward, I got this phone call from my mother saying, "What's the matter, Steve? You're going to be a bum all your life." Well, maybe. I don't know. It's funny, my high school guidance counselor never even suggested this. But anyway, that original bike was a simpler incarnation of this. It was actually the same frame. And in 1983, things were a little different. The computing power on board was a Radio Shack Model 100 little laptop, which was an amazing, stunning 32K of memory and a 300 baud modem. And I mean, this was such a liberating device to be able to work on such a small thing. And CompuServe was just down the street from me in Ohio, so I couldn't ignore that implication. There was no internet yet. There were these little isolated layers of data space that were starting to pop up that didn't talk to each other, so you had to have accounts on everything, to talk to your friends. But CompuServe was handy and close, and they loved the idea, so they gave me a free account, which is pretty exciting back then, one of my first sponsors. And so all of a sudden, I had this radical combination, which, oddly enough, hadn't really manifested itself in the public eye very much yet, which was nomadic connectivity. It didn't matter where I was. Because fundamentally, I was a freelance writer. That's what I did for a living. So just such a simple thing as taking a laptop and a modem and a network connection back then was really, really weird. And what I did not anticipate at all was that the media went completely bonkers over this. It was visible. It was on a recumbent bicycle, which was sort of a strange thing at the time. There was a little solar panel, a little 5-watt panel up in the front here, under where this is now, that powered everything. And I just took off. And after it took me a couple of months to sort of calm down and stop thinking about state lines and 1,000-mile marks and realize that I actually lived on the road now. And soon the bike became known as the Winnebiko. I got to tell you where that name came from, actually. At about 3,000 miles into it, I did a CBS Morning News filming, which was my first big one. And it was pretty stressful and intense, and I was learning about sound bites and why I didn't know how to do it yet. And they finally left me alone. I pitched camp. and just settled into a nice quiet corner of this campground in Lake Livingston, Texas, on the lake, stirring dinner in the little cook stove, and then this big motorhome pulled in right next to me and just sat there with the engine running right in my face. You know, it would completely obscure all of you here. And so I'm sort of stirring dinner and looking at this thing, and then I hear another engine start up, which is the generator, and then there's this as the satellite dish went up for watching television. And then clunk, and the hydraulic step went down. And finally the door opened, the main engine went down, but the generator's still running, and the leveling jacks are going down, and all this stuff is happening in my face. And this very large man started backing out of the motorhome with this thing in his hands, which I couldn't quite see, but as he was backing down, I could see wheels and green tubing and so on. And he finally got clear, and it's this lawn boy lawnmower, and he mowed the grass around his campsite. And then broke out, of course, the lanterns and all those other normal campground things. And it was funny, in the morning I spoke with him, and just to like this meeting of alien cultures, just to try to understand. And he says, "Well, sir, you know, I live down around Houston, and it's nice to come up to God's country now and then and get away from it all, you know?" Right. So anyway, that was this odd little moment in the trip that sort of made me realize how many ways there are to do this. But anyway, I was continuing west, and in Texas, West Texas, there was West Texas in July, by the way, is a really bad idea. Don't, if you're contemplating a bike trip, don't do it. Considering where we are, I have to tell you this. Very early in the trip, I was hunkered down on the ground in Christiansburg, Ohio. I was only like 2 days away from home, and I was still very new at this, very self-conscious. And I was sitting on the ground in this little town, clapboard houses, and one main street. And I had the acoustic cups plugged into the only payphone, and I had the little Model 100 on the ground, and I'm getting my mail. And I hear this sort of rattle-trap old truck pull up beside me, and this farmer gets out, and he's got a Caterpillar tractor hat, and he's chawing tobacco, and he looks at this thing and comes over and squats down and touches the chain and nods sagely and spat tobacco juice and says, "Are you with NASA?" So I said, "Why, yes, sir, this here is one of those loony excursion modules." He goes, "Ah, okay." So anyway, I was in West Texas on one of these long, lonely days, and stories were writing themselves in my head and evaporating, which had become a rather horrible pattern, because fundamentally I was still hand-to-mouth freelance writing, and now, even though I was having lots of things to write about, I was busying myself with riding the bike, falling in love, cleaning up, climbing mountains, everything except actually sitting down and working. So the adventure was no magical cure for bad work habits, and I was starting to feel the pinch financially. But so I was watching this happen again, and it suddenly hit me that what I really needed to do was be able to write while writing. That would be the key. And so I play flute, and on a flute you get multiple finger combinations give you in different notes, so you can get 3 octaves out of 9 fingers, right? Unlike a piano keyboard, which is like a QWERTY keyboard. So I thought, I'll just put a keyboard in the handlebars and type in ASCII. Well, that idea led to the Winnebico 2, which wasn't very imaginatively named, but it was a console kind of like this. I took the Model 100, repackaged it, stuck it in the console, tons of switches for things like power supplies and packet radio and all kinds of other goodies, and put 4 keys in each handlebar so I could type in ASCII, and literally just A, B, C, D, E, F, G, just straight binary, with these fingers being shift, control, and numeric. And I actually got fairly good at it. I could do about 35 words a minute while going down the road, and I wrote some simple code that would let me type in macros so I could expand macros on the fly, although there weren't many of them back then because it was embedded in a little HC11. But that was really neat because all of a sudden now, with packet radio built in and the computer built in, I could be pedaling down the road and writing stories. The only problem was is that machine, I'm kind of glossing over this one because I want to talk about this, it was kind of architecturally inflexible. I did about 6,000 miles on it on both coasts after 10,000 on the original version. See, I do measure things in miles, don't I? And the problem was that as new technology came out, which is constantly seductive, it was very hard to add things to the bike because adding a cell phone, for example, came along a little after the thing was built, and it involved reassigning silk-screened switches and just hacking stuff in such a way that the documentation, which was already bad, became even less useful, and pretty soon it was just this rat's nest of wires and things with no reassigning of anything. So I started fantasizing about this version, which is Behemoth, and it's sort of aptly named. It stands for Big Electronic Human Energized Machine, Only Too Heavy. This was a 3.5-year project which took place from about 89 to 91, something like that. It was born here in Silicon Valley. It was sitting on top of the same old frame that had all those miles on it. I had various labs scattered around the place. Ultimately, the one at Sun Microsystems, they donated a piece of one of their buildings for quite a while, and that's where it finally rolled out. But the idea here was to take all of those ideas and sort of turn it into this sort of great technological tour de force, and it actually works, but it was really heavy. So anyway, let me give you the quick tour of the bike. The power comes from solar panels. There's 72 watts of solar panels there, and batteries scattered here and there that gather all that power. Communications was a major deal because now there was an internet happening, so the world had changed completely. You no longer needed 7 or 8 different accounts in order to talk to all your friends. One was plenty. So Qualcomm donated this Omnitracs terminal here, which you've seen on trucks all over the highway. And this is kind of a magical little thing. Of course, everything on a bike must be multifunctional, so it also makes an excellent salad bowl. But this little antenna whips around and locks onto the, I guess it was using the GTE G-Star satellite and synchronizes with it. And then wherever the bike goes, it just follows that same bird. And there's a 14 gigahertz uplink and 12 gigahertz downlink. Unfortunately, that's not data rate. This was a long time ago, and the data, 165 bits per second was what we got out of it. So it wasn't really for web surfing, but there was no web. So it didn't matter. About a week to download a GIF, I think. But it was really neat because I had a console Macintosh here with Eudora running in it. I could be pedaling down the road, and there was a little POP server that we wrote that pretended to be a ISP. And so Eudora was perfectly satisfied. It would just do its mail thing with that. And then that piece of code went down and did some magic binary stuff with the little processor underneath this thing. Incidentally, for a number of years now, I've been doing speaking gigs as a way of making a living, and one of the strangest ones was Pac Bell hired me to do the Pac Bell Texpo, which was a trade show of various partners for the company. And I had to do 11 half-hour speeches in the booth, which is kind of a pain, but that's okay, it paid. And so I was just getting ready for the first one. So the bike's all up, the crowd's gathered, I'm sort of, okay, here goes. And the client walked over and sort of sidled up to me and he said, I want you to play down your bypass methodologies. What's a bypass methodology? And he goes, you know. And I realized that from the Pac Bell perspective, this is a way of getting around using the phone system, you see. So they didn't like that very much. How do I talk about it? What's that? Oh, it's a salad bowl. Anyway, the user interface here, one of the goals was to make this all work nicely while mobile. So here's how it works. It's kind of, I often think of this as being sort of the Macintosh of bicycles, you know, because basically it doesn't hurt to use it, unlike, well, we won't go there. But wrapped around my head here is what we called the brain interface unit. There's a little heads-up display. It's a little 720 by 280 computer screen, which back in 1991 was pretty amazing. It gave me a little PC screen that would float in space in front of me. And there was a Macintosh here, so I could sort of attention switch between my left and right eye. And all that was sort of below my binocular vision, which contains all the non-maskable interrupts like trucks and things. And and then cursor control is these little ultrasonic sensors here. So instead of trying to build a mouse into the handlebars, which is kind of a pain, I would move my head around and the cursor would track. There's three little ultrasonic receivers and a 40 kilohertz signal transmitted from the console. So as we get phase and Doppler data from head movement, which got turned into quadrature and then in an Apple desktop bus. So basically, and of course, it's handlebar keyboard, as always. So that combination gave me the whole user interface. And what it felt like was being in this sort of big workstation where reality was sort of the root, this image on the back of that's on your screen. And there's all these little windows, which are all the other stuff that you're doing. And the only downside of that is that in boring places like, say, Crossing Kansas, for example, I couldn't rearrange them and put the page layout program out there and put reality down in here. I mean, how much bandwidth do you need, you know? But the funny thing is that it ended up being very immersive. And you know, I didn't have a lot of time on the road because I started fantasizing about the boat idea almost immediately. But there was one strange little 3-day period of being in Wisconsin. And I was working on a deadline for somebody, some trade journal, and you know, just spending a lot of time writing and in this little world while reality was just kind of going by. And then suddenly I was in Sheboygan, college town, sunny day, pretty people. And I turned and looked at somebody, and I had this flash of irritation because the system had failed. The cursor didn't move. I wanted to double click and launch that application, you know. And it didn't work. Incidentally, a couple other things about the helmet. These are headlights. I've always felt very lightheaded when they were on. And there was the problem with wearing a big styrofoam insulator on your head when you're on a heavy thing like this is that it blocks your body's normal favorite cooling paths. So it, actually, overheating was a real problem. And so there's a 7-liter tank back here, a little peristaltic pump that I stole for something else that is where that mark is, and a little heat exchanger that I wore inside the helmet. It was made by Life Support Systems, and I could circulate ice water through the helmet liner and pull about 75 watts out of my head. Didn't do anything with it. I just put crushed ice and water in the tank. It wasn't like I used that power for anything. But I was going up a hill in Wisconsin, and very, very, very slowly. They're really steep. And so I'm in my granny gear, which is 7.9 inches. There's 105 speeds. I describe it as having a technology to compensate for the weight of all the technology. So anyway, I'm crawling up this hill, and this farmer has lots of time to stop his tractor, saunter over to his fence, light up his pipe, you know, lean on the fence, and watch me approach. And as I pulled abreast of him, he just sort of gestured, because I was burning up, you know, and I'm doing this while riding. He says, "You get much extra power out of that hand crank setup back there?" And the ironic thing about that question is that the answer is actually yes, because the body derating and all that stuff. Let's see, architecturally, the whole idea, as I said, was to have something that was sort of infinitely reconfigurable. And we took a pretty good stab in that direction. It got better with the boat, but basically the architecture of this thing depends on cross-point switches. So there's audio cross-points here in the rump, the rear unit of many purposes, and back here in the wazoo, or the wheeled auxiliary storage unit. All of those things had audio cross-point switches in them and sort of rudimentary serial cross-points so that anything can be connected to anything on the fly. The favorite example is security. If there were 6 security sensors scattered around the boat, microwave motion, physical movement like this, like basically a car alarm, switches on access panels, et cetera. And if anybody would wiggle it, the speech synthesizer would wake up, the stereo would wake up, the former would be routed to the latter through the cross point, and a string would be sent to the synthesizer that says, "Do not touch or you will be vaporized by a laser beam." Obviously a hollow threat, but you know what's amazing? Psychologically, I want to make stickers and sell them that say, "Warning, this vehicle protected by a powerful psychological deterrent." Makes you wonder. But anyway, I was down in South Alabama one time, and that happened, and they all just took a couple steps back, you know, nodded sagely, kept on talking about it, and they didn't go away, but they just definitely were all out of arm's reach. At Apple, I had the bike on display in Mariani campus in the old days, and somebody touched it, and it said the same thing, and they're all over it. It's like, is that the Berkeley Speech Technologies algorithm? Well, what's he, you know? So you got to sort of fine-tune your speech string to the audience. Of course, the extreme version of that security system was another one of the sort of reconfigurable through the crossbar things, which is there's a GPS receiver, which was a tiny little thing from Trimble about this big. Things have changed. And if the latitude and longitude were to change without the right password, it was something like 6 or 8 lines of code or something to dial 911 and say, "Hello, I'm a bicycle, I'm being stolen, my present coordinates are," et cetera. Anyway, the idea there is that with all these things being able to be reconfigured, I could sort of cast the hardware in stone, so to speak, which I really thought I had accomplished until about 2 weeks after finishing this, when when the new neat color active matrix LCD came out, which I really wanted a lot more than the one that's in there. The Mac was great, but this flips up and there's a VGA display under it. It's mechanical display paging. And the one under there, which looked beautiful in a dark room, if you were outside, you couldn't even tell if it was on or not. So basically, that whole system was dead weight. So this new thing came out from Sharp, and I got all excited, and then discovered that to install it would require remachining the whole front panel, and you know, so we hit the road instead. Serviceability was a really major design goal here. The Winnebago 2 didn't have much serviceability. If I dropped a screw down in it, I had to take the whole thing off and turn it upside down and rattle it. maintaining boards which were packed really densely, that I was terribly proud of when I was building them, turned out to be a nightmare because things are all dangling off of cables and shorting against themselves and so on. So we decided when doing Behemoth that that wouldn't be the case. Thanks. I used to get this really perverse pleasure out of pulling into bike shops and saying, can you help me with this? At speeds greater than 20, I'm dropping Ethernet packets. And so I won't bore you with the details of this technology, but basically Mac, a couple of 40 megabyte hard drives. Ooh, that was just 40 megs each, two of them. That was wretched excess, wasn't it? There's the 286 that I ended up not using because the display couldn't be read. Most of this stuff was pretty useful. There's the GPS receiver. Audio cross point there, I want to acknowledge Steve Sargent right here who did all the audio design. Then this is a little packet terminal node controller that will let me do packet radio email and things like that while mobile. And speaking of volunteers, somewhere, where's Dave? Zonker. There you are. David Harris, when I was working on this in the lab at Sun, he was a newlywed. Was it like a week or something you'd been married? He started coming over every night after work with a quick stop for fast food and would work until about midnight doing wiring on this thing. I mean, like, this is like the ultimate volunteer. He had a lot to do with the design, and especially wiring these nightmare connectors that were really tiny things. But anyway, this the culture around the bike, and that's what I wanted to lead up to, is there was this period when the internet was happening, when all of a sudden I wasn't depending upon the few random friends who live near me in Columbus, Ohio, to sort of get involved in the project. All of a sudden, people were popping up from all over the place. And this era, about 10 years ago, when this was being built, was right at the beginning of that, where a culture started to build around the bike. People would meet each other in the lab. There was a lot of give and take. Something like 160 corporate sponsors, about 45 volunteers, a lot of really smart people. And a lot of the biggest pleasure for me was just the chance to have this sort of bi-directional information flow and the creative contributions of lots of rather amazing folks. Well, so I hit the road in 1991. And gosh, oh yeah, this again. I was back on the road, sweaty, working. Every time I'd stop at a restaurant or a gas station or something like that, I'd get off the bike and the crowd would gather. And by now, so much media had been happening around this. I did an hour on the Donahue Show, front page Wall Street Journal, Discover Magazine, all these things. The problem was that the culture I found myself immersed in, being on the highway, just sort of out there cross country, became rather exhausting. I mean, this is you people are techies in Silicon Valley and, all sorts of interesting people. The problem out there was, just one question, what's all that do? Is that front wheel small so you're always going downhill? where's the other guys sit? is that a television? You can't be rude. These are all reasonable questions. And I was sort of an agent of future shock, and I spent a lot of time explaining and demoing. But basically, I was starting to really think it'd be kind of nice to just be out on the water and sort of drift and relax. Also, I started finding that there's an interesting thing about water is that there's not a lot of hills on it, except really temporary ones. And so that started getting really alluring. And somewhere in 1991, while pedaling up along the shore of Lake Michigan, I started looking out across the lake going, if I could just wrap a hull around this thing. And obviously that wouldn't work because, the packaging would never survive. Especially if I went to salt water. What they say, water corrodes, and salt water corrodes absolutely. But that sort of planted the seed, and then sometime later I got turned on to sea kayaking, and one thing led to another, and pretty soon the microchip project was born. So what I want to do right now is just kind of give you kind of a quick description of the microchip, which is the new machine, but you'll actually see it over at the reception, so I'm not going to try to give you much of a visual description because that's sort of hard to do. Basically, it's a 19-foot canoe with training wheels, the training wheels being outriggers. This has training wheels too, but they're actually landing gear. Don't call them training wheels. So the boat is a little trimaran, and I wanted right from the start to be able to have multiple modes of propulsion, not including big engines. So obviously there's a sail. There's a 93 square foot roller furling vertically battened sail, which is a 21 foot mast, really works quite well. There's pedal drive, couldn't escape my bicycling roots here. So in the hull of the canoe, there's some double throw pedals, which are coupled to a little 13-inch model airplane propeller, which moves 10 times the pedaling speed and moves the boat at 4 knots, amazingly. And there's also an electric thruster, which is actually one of the most interesting applications of the network of processors that are in the boat. There's a little Minn Kota thruster that hangs off the back. And there's 480 watts of solar panels. Just to put that in perspective, this is 72, okay? So this is a canoe with about two ping pong tables worth of solar panels, which are these big folding arrays that fill all the spaces in between hulls. That can generate about 36 amps. So we have this box of processors. And one of the things it does is optimize all of the coupling from the solar panels into the battery. Their solar panels are split into 8 channels of 60 watts each. And each one of those is being actively managed by an algorithm called peak power tracking, where you track the actual product of voltage and current rather than just hook it up to the battery and hope for the best. So all of this stuff is coming into the system. And then the thruster, the goal is we want to be able to move the boat electrically with as much speed as possible without killing the battery for normal cruise applications. So there's another little processor that spends its time just sort of optimizing the thruster control. And what happens is you say, all right, give me maximum free speed. And it starts to turn up the thruster power until it reaches a point where it balances all the incoming solar power, the system loads, whatever the battery is doing, and so on. And then it just hovers right around that magic point. So if the if cloud goes over the sun, I slow down. I turn off a piece of equipment. I speed up. Whatever. But it actually tracks the power budget. And then there's a rather rudely named mode, which I won't give you the name of. But if you discover that you're suddenly on a collision course with a freighter, you can override all that stuff and just go as fast as possible. So the other fundamental requirement of this little boat is that we wanted to be able to essentially live on it and be able to move in and out of the water with reasonable alacrity, sleep on the water, which is actually a problem because it's sort of incompatible with a centerboard in a canoe. That's really uncomfortable. So we had to put that off center. And the real requirement was getting in and out of the water easily. And the catch is that with all of this stuff that's been added, now it's too heavy to just, beach like a kayak, jump out and drag it above tide line. That doesn't work anymore. And so the whole kayak canoe world wasn't quite accessible. And yet, it's not really a liveaboard. It's not a yacht. You don't go to marinas in this thing because the center hull is about this wide, And in between the liveaboard world and the kayak and canoe world, there's only trailer sailors, which means some truck would be following us around the country, dragging the thing out with a trailer at every ramp. And that sounds really boring. If we can do that, just ride the truck, So we added landing gear. They had to be amphibian. So the microship has deployable wheels, which retract just like aircraft landing gear and stow under the solar panels. And you pull levers, and they extend and rotate to just the right angle and end up down on extended below the water. And then you just hit the beach, hop out, and drag it up the beach. Problem was, of course, that things like wheel geometry, steering geometry, and things like that are fairly non-trivial. So we ended up needing active hydraulic control for the steering and about 1,000 components, which I'll show you later. But all of this stuff has taken about the last 5 or 6 years of design and fabrication. And where we are in the project right now is we have one working boat that has been on the water 4 times and a second working boat, which is Natasha, my partner. We've decided that we really need 2 boats. These are far too small to coexist on. So there are 2 microships based on 19-foot canoes. She describes hers as being generation 2, having learned from all my agony about the landing gear. Hers are simpler and maybe work a little better. So the whole status of the project now is we have working boats, and as soon as we get back to our lab in Camino Island, Washington, which will occur here fairly soon, another couple weeks, we start electronics packaging. And all that I said about the cross points and system management, all that stuff about this has now been refined in the microchips to the point where it actually works really well. We have 3 flavors of cross point switches, serial, audio, and video. Serial looks like a big matrix of 28 DB9 connectors. And I got to tell you, this is so funny because the whole trend in networking is toward, obviously TCP/IP, Ethernet, high-speed stuff, fiber, all the stuff that works really well and makes the internet go. The problem is that when you try to network a whole bunch of little really stupid things like, ham radio controllers, speech synthesizers, GPSs, compasses, wind sensors, all this little stuff, all these things are way too stupid to run networking protocols. So you end up with this need to just constantly switch things back and forth, and it can be a real headache in a complicated system. So what this little box does is you just plug all of this junk into these little DB9 serial connectors, and then the processor that runs the whole show, which is Linux, can say, okay, channel 5, talk to channel 21, and the little processor that runs that thing in turn takes pin 2 and 3 of each one, which is transmit and receive, successively connects them to a window comparator to see if they're a transmitter or a receiver, and then makes either a virtual straight cable or a virtual no modem cable and makes the connection. So all of a sudden, you can randomly connect serial devices for fun without fiddling around for about 2 hours with cables and adapters, and we've all been there. So that's a key part of the system. The audio that came out of this works beautifully, so that gives us 32 inputs and 32 outputs, which takes care of all the things like cell phones and ham radios and VHFs and speech synthesizers and all that other stuff. And there's also a video crosspoint, which has 16 video inputs and 8 video outputs. And Natasha's boat, hers has become the audio-visual boat. She has a nonlinear digital video editing system called the Draco Casablanca, so she can produce digital video productions on the fly while sailing. So she has a video turret that's on her boat that can steer a camera at any angle or scan between a pair of angles. And there's somewhere around 8 or 10 boats or cameras scattered around both boats with wireless links between them. So she'll be able to sit there and grab channels and then sort of on the fly put together this stuff. It's also great for security because, you know, we could be sitting in a cafe someplace with the boats on the beach, and if the security system is triggered, it can beep us. We can bring up a window and basically what it looks like a browser environment and look at a webcam, which is delivered via wireless Ethernet. So all the things that are sort of becoming standard for communications on the internet are things that we're now doing both between the boats and between the boats and the backpacks. Sitting on top of the whole mess, as I mentioned, is a Linux box. And we were going to do the whole front end in a browser, but now we're just in the process of experimenting with Squeak, which is a flavor of Smalltalk. So we can sort of build little graphic widgets on the fly and wire them together. So it'll basically feel like sitting at a web browsing environment to drive these little canoes. And it also lets us say canoes, not Unix. which, you know, we had to have some reason for it. See, on the bike, I always wanted to ride a Unix cycle, so there's a spark station in this box. So, So to kind of give you the context of all this, the plan here, we're going to take off in March. The disclaimer is every time I've given any kind of predictions about where I'm going in any of these machines, they've all turned out to be wrong. So basically, what we're going to do is a big loop around the inland and coastal waterways of the United States. I'm not quite sure where that loop will start, probably somewhere in the Missouri River, maybe in Florida, because there's a thing that sounds like real fun down there in March. But essentially, the Tenom Waterway, the Gulf Coast, all the way around the Keys, up the Atlantic Coast and the ICW, either up the Hudson and across the Erie Canal or around Maine and the St. Lawrence, depending on weather, et cetera. Through the Great Lakes and the Trans-Severn Waterway, down the upper Mississippi or through Chicago, and you know, et cetera. But a big loop like that. And then Natasha, being a European, is clamoring for our next trip to be in the Greek islands and around the canals of Europe. So that's kind of the plan, is to get this done and get on with it. So you can track all of this at our website, which is microship.com. And we also have a mailing list on the web, which is of course on the net, which is of course free. Just give me your email address or click the little widget on the website, and we put out regular postings, which update all the stuff that we're doing. And at this point, I'd like to see if there's any questions about anything, bike or boat. Yeah.
Where do you put the cat?
Ah, good question. Natasha's boat is going to have her. Well, you'll see the boat when you see mine. Mine has a cowling that's sort of this like sort of smooth hood that will have all the electronics under it. Hers has a little bit more of a rectangular cross section, and it wraps around with windows in the front. It'll be called 10 Forward. And and her cowling will lift up, and inside there is a cat carrier, which is integrated with it, so the windows line up. And then you can just pluck the cat carrier out. It has wheels that fold down, and that's also a way of carrying packs and things like that. So Java is the cat, and she will be. We got some great pictures today. She was on top of a cray earlier, and then one. So she's a little tech kitty. Yeah. Fun. Yeah. I've spent my whole career trying to avoid honest work. I never outgrew science fairs. You know, and one of the things that I always found, I mean, seriously, I actually mean that, because in school I had this horrible realization that the whole reason that I was in school was not to satisfy my curiosity, but to satisfy somebody else's expectations. And so the real work of school was the sort of crank-turning process of working for approval. You know, okay, what do you want me to do? All right, here's that, you know, and so on. And it had nothing to do with my own curiosity and my own interests. And where I found the outlet, which kept me sane as a kid, was science fairs, because all of a sudden I could take the things that I found interesting and throw myself into them with lots and lots of passion and energy. And that was things like speech synthesizers and speech compressors and, you know, harmonographs and just, you know, all kinds of stuff. Made the International as a senior, et cetera. And, you know, as what's funny, because you get out of high school and then they send you off to college, and all of a sudden it's the same old stuff again, except it's harder and there's no science fairs. You know, so so I dropped out of college right away. Did like 2 quarters of freshman year, and sort of bummed around, and finally found that the real outlet was to start my own little business, which was basically a way of funding my hobby, which was, again, like the science fair thing, doing whatever I found really fun. And surprise, when you get out of college and you go into industry, it's the same thing all over again. You sit in the cubicle, becoming a specialist, getting narrower and narrower vision, working to make somebody else's dream come true and get promotions, et cetera. And I've seen so many friends who have gone down that path, become incredibly expert at something, but the personal cost is a sort of loss of passion and freedom, et cetera. So what I finally figured out is that there's this actually a balance here. That's all necessary. And this industry wouldn't exist if it weren't for millions of people doing exactly that. At the same time, there has to be somebody doing cross-pollination and you know, living those dreams. And those, and I'm obviously not the only one, they're all called people like, you know, consultants and writers and, you know, people who live in the boundaries between specialties and jump around between all these different minds that people work in. So, sort of a long answer to your question, but basically it's a way of doing what I find fun at any given moment and getting away with it somehow. A little bit and not enough, actually. That's probably the biggest weakness right now in what we're doing is we don't have a technology transfer joint venture partner to take the really cool stuff and market it. But having said that, I always feel a little awkward about that because the whole reason this system has come together is the free donated contributions of people's time, their products, et cetera. And to then take all of that and say, ha, mine, and go off and sell it doesn't feel quite right either. So for the whole software development environment on the microchip, we're doing it on SourceForge, running it all open source. I think it's going to be GPL. You know, we're publishing widely all the technical details of the boat, which I should have done with this, but never got to it. But we're taking all the technical details of the boat right down to the schematic level and putting it in a book called Inside the Microchip, et cetera. So I think that's, and what's funny is that the secondary spin-offs of all this have actually been feeding me for all these years. So I don't think I actually need to productize to make a living. Speaking engagements, you know, other projects, freelance writing, et cetera. So, yeah.
What does mom say now?
Well, she's not around anymore, but my dad loves it. And yeah, it was funny as things developed. I think what finally made it work for them was seeing it in the media. It's like, oh well, maybe that's okay because you know they believed in what was on TV. And once I got on TV, then maybe I wasn't a bum after all. So, any more? Yes?
I was wondering, when you did your initial ASCII typewriter, why didn't you just buy a standard chord typewriter?
A standard chord typewriter?
Yeah.
I didn't really know of any back then. People had thought of the idea before, obviously. I looked at court reporter type keyboards, but there were too many keys. And fairly long learning curve, although they're really fast. That was nice. But there's like two or three rows of keys. It's way more than I could fit in the keyboard. It did evolve to a commercial chord keyboard. This one ended up using a thing called the InfoGrip BAT, which is actually a commercial product. And just because, why reinvent the wheel? You know, it had been done. It was in a chip, so it kept me from having to put it in the chip. I'll probably end up doing that on the boat, too, although in the boat I don't have the same packaging constraints that I do on the bike. I actually have my hands free. So I'll probably have a little waterproof industrial keyboard I can drag out and stick in my lap for fast stuff, and then just have a little cord keyboard and one of the rudder T-handles, just for little stuff. So. Yes?
Would you build this with today's technology? How much
larger? Oh, lots. Yeah, I've actually thought about that a lot. It would be a lot smaller, and it wouldn't be called Behemoth. It would probably be so much smaller that I wouldn't need the trailer. Which would be nice. It's kind of nice having all my stuff in the trailer, but you know, there's a definite, every time you use, on level ground I would be cruising at 12 miles an hour or something, and then I'd hit a hill, and it's just astounding what gravity can do. there was a lot of redundancy in this, which wasn't necessary. Too many PCs, too many separate environments. The other fundamental design error, which I would certainly not do again, is having separate enclosures for things. You know, I had the systems up here. This area back here has security, stereo, just a bunch of other stuff, wireless modem, things like that. And then there's an enclosure back here, which is the rear two-thirds of the trailer that has ham radio equipment and a bunch of other audio stuff. So, you know, that all sounds neat, but the problem was that every one of those had to be packaged, powered, enclosed, had connector protocols, cabling in between. And the net effect was that it was so complicated that adding a new component was really a lot of work, despite the crossbars. That actually ended up being the simple part. The reality was running cables is something you just don't want to do. So what I would do now, which is pretty much what I'm doing in the boat, is it's all in one box. There's one smart processor, the Linux box, that sits on top of everything, and then microcontrollers as necessary to do the dirty work. So it would be little. So, yes. I'd say more and more integration of gadgets. One of the biggest frustrations is separate power supplies and cables and protocols for all the little pocket things, you know. And that's going to be a real headache, you know. The ham radio, the cell phone, the palm, the laptop, all of those things have their own little kit of junk that go with them. and all the different ways of talking to each other. I know we're getting there with Bluetooth and so on, but I'm really looking forward to a convergence of things that eliminates all of that garbage. Just batteries, for example. I don't know why we still are suffering with wall warts with different connectors, you know, for different products. I mean, come on, you know, it's a battery. Feed it something; it'll sort it out. There's enough chips around now to actually do that. So that's probably the biggest one. It's just the irritation of those things. Speaking of interesting gadgets, though, I have one of my favorite new toys, which I've been testing extensively on this road trip, is this. This is a Qualcomm GSP-1600, I think. It's a Globalstar phone, and it's tri-mode. It's a Globalstar satellite as well as analog 800 megahertz and CDMA 800 megahertz. And it talks to a constellation of birds that are flitting about, even as we speak. And we'll do data at 7 to 13 kilobaud as well as voice. And this is certainly another one of those nice little convergence things, because I'm getting more stuff in small packages. So. This or the bike? Fully loaded for touring, it's about 580 pounds plus me. Empty, as it's sitting right now, it's about 400 pounds. It's about the same power to weight ratio, given my body, which is not a spectacular Olympian type body. It's about the same power to weight ratio as a lawnmower engine running a tractor trailer rig. Just to put it in perspective. Any more? Yes. Oh, get under something. I had a fabric cover that Velcroed over the outside of the console, which protected the front panel really well. A baggie that went over the heads-up display, and everything else was pretty waterproof. And then, of course, skin is waterproof, but if it was cold, I'd put on stuff. Interesting, I did get in a real thunderstorm once with lightning. There, on an earlier version of this, there was a xenon strobe at the top of the support for the 2-meter antenna here. And that a lightning struck so close that flashed three times in rapid succession. So that was close enough. So, yes? Oh, yeah, actually, I stole the antennas off of this. This is called the BYP, or the Big Yellow Pole. And that one wasn't very imaginative. This goes up, if it's not tangled. OK, trust me, it goes up to about 12 feet. And these little fittings right here unfold, and there was a dipole antenna on each one of the, or I'm sorry, a whip antenna, an outbacker whip on each one of these. So it would normally just be this bundle that was all tied here, but when I wanted to do HF ham radio, I would fold out this dipole of tuned whips. And it was actually kind of a simple idea. Normally those whips are used standalone, like you put them on your car and the car is the ground plane or the counterpoise. Problem is the bike's not enough of a counterpoise to be useful below maybe 10 to 15 meter band, roughly. So I made a dipole out of these things, and then I'd unfold that, stick it up in the air, and then I could talk to people all around the world. It was fun, by the way, to work bicycle mobile, especially back then. I could run the dipole in vertical mode and actually pedal while doing it. Horizontal would tend to sort of sag. But I was talking to some guy in Italy one time, and I couldn't get him to believe that I was actually pedaling a bicycle at the moment. No, he just kept challenging me, and I went, no, really? But the most ridiculous one, actually, was, and this was not practical, this was just for amusement. I was getting into Oscar 13 for a while, which is ham radio satellites. And the way you operated with Oscar 13 was with two big cross-Yagi antennas, one for 2 meters and one for 440. And these things are like 10 to 15 feet long. They're fairly big, clunky things. And people usually put them out on a big rotor out in their yard or up in their roof. But I took these things and clamped them to the pole here and sat still. I was over in Milpitas, in fact. And got the thing sort of aimed up at the birds. And, oh, David, you remember this. I was living with this guy at the time. And aimed the things up at the Oscar 13 satellite, which was on a Molniya orbit, which is a poor man's geosynchronous. And I had a Yaesu radio's 290 and 790 models, which are these multi-mode little rigs. So anyway, I started sitting here chatting with this guy down in Burnie, Tasmania, I think, a fellow named Frank. And so while talking with him, I slowly sort of dragged the cables over, put stuff on top of the trailer, sat on the bike, and started riding down the street. Just to say I'd done it. So I'm still talking via Oscar 13 with Frank and Burnie, Tasmania, who inevitably, as all hams ultimately do in a conversation, a QSO, will say, well, what are your operating conditions there, old man? And I said, well, I'm bicycle mobile at the moment. And he interrupted me, which you can actually do on Oscar 13 because it's full duplex. And he came back and says, only in America, you people are crazy, you know? So sort of summed it right up, I guess. But yeah.
Possible to so that you'll be comfortable in the future, say when you're working on the microchip,
Oh, yeah, you mean just packaging issues and things like that? Oh, you know, small is getting pretty attractive. The space and weight budget on the boat is so restrictive that we're really packing things tightly. There's a lot of surface mount boards now and things that I know I won't be able to work on in the field if they fail, which scares me a little bit. Because, I mean, this was very serviceable. It was all pretty, except for things like commercial boards hacked out of laptops and things, it was all pretty clunky, big through-hole stuff, which I could work on in campgrounds. We're going to have to put together some kind of a spares protocol to solve that. But I do carry a little mobile R&D lab. You know, there's a little portable oscilloscope and butane soldering iron and, you know, fairly good stock of chips and so on. So, yeah. Yes?
What was your most common maintenance problem
with the bike? The bike or my body? Tires, about one every 1,000 miles, roughly. A few other things failed here and there. Oddly enough, the electronics was fairly robust. I mean, it's been beat up quite a bit now, and connectors have fallen off and things, you know. But actually, on the road, I would say it's pretty much mechanical things, pretty much like with all computers, you know. The things that are the moving parts, the printers, the disk drives, all that stuff is always where the problems tend to be, not in the silicon. And connectors. Always a headache. But of course, having said all that, I should mention that as the system's complexity approaches infinity, the mean time between failures approaches zero. So there's always something, you know. But I can't draw any conclusions about what class of problems there were. It was just always a little surprise. So. Well, any more? What's our timing look like? Yeah.
Do you have any sponsors from the bicycle industry?
Not really from the bicycle industry. Maybe aftermarket bicycle stuff like pedals and things like that. The cranks were CQP. There were some various bike components here and there that were donated. But strangely, back in when this was being built in the late 80s, the bicycle industry was still looking at recumbents like some kind of weird fringe fad, you know. Which is funny because, well, trimarans, you can say about the same thing. You know, it's where the action is. It attracts, you know, both brilliance and weirdos, and, you know, it's not part of the mainstream. So you have all the same kind of arguments back and forth about which is better. I actually called Schwinn once in some moment of desperation, thinking, oh, maybe I should get a corporate sponsor. And so I called them, and they actually said, we don't believe in recumbents. We don't think they'll ever be popular. So history is very slowly proving that to not be the case. I'm happy to see that it's taken at least twice as long as I thought it would take, but there's a lot of really nice recumbents out there and people who are actually making money at it, which is good to see. But back then, this was way too strange. And the bicycle industry has always been really style-driven. In the old days, it was all racing style. You had to be sleek and fast and have thin tires and aero components. And, you know, then it kind of moved into the mountain bike style, where even if you never got off pavement, you had to have all these incredibly rugged components and shock mounts and things. And so I remember I pulled into a bike shop in Aspen one time, which, you know, talk about a hotbed of style orientation. And I just went in to buy some shoes. That's all I wanted, was just plain old bike shoes, which they had. But I could not get the guys to talk to me because I was wearing terry cloth shorts and a T-shirt and just, you know, I didn't look the type. I didn't fit, so I went and bought them at the cheap shop down the street. Any more questions? What? Yes. No, it's actually electronically pretty dead right now. I discovered about a year ago that somewhere in all these thousands of miles I've been dragging it around, I have this big truck and trailer, and I've been doing the speaking tours for the last few years to make a living, and I haven't been maintaining the bike very well, so the power system sort of died, and she's sort of static right now, unfortunately. Sorry about that. Did somebody else have a hand up? You? Yeah.
How many hours do you usually ride each day?
That varied all over the place. I'm not a racer. I was never trying to set records or anything, so I'm kind of the exact opposite of the people who do Race Across America and such. I would often just get on the bike and then 30 miles later find some interesting place to stop. It's hard to give you an average. Pretty short days. I tend to get up late, spend a while getting caffeinated, you know, and packed. And and then eventually kind of hit the road, maybe, you know. And, you know, sometimes I would just take so long to do that that I'd end up staying a whole day where I was. So the important thing to note here is that this is actually a really important point, because a lot of bike trips, and by metaphorical extension, a lot of projects, end up being interludes in your life where you sort of say, okay, I'm going to take a break from what I do. I'm going to go do this adventure. I'm going to cross the United States on a bicycle. And you got, you know, 3 weeks of vacation. So you're watching the calendar and you're, you know, planning your days, et cetera. This was actually a lifestyle. This became home. I was homeless and unemployed. I don't know what the fuss was all about. and after I realized that I'd actually moved to the bicycle rather than was doing a bicycle trip, then speed really wasn't an issue at all. If I was happy where I was, then why leave? So I tended to just meander. Yeah?
Is that reason you never considered electric traction motor on your
Oh, I certainly did. Actually, one of the things that was on the hot to-do list here that never got done was a variable reluctance motor generator that was to be the front wheel hub. And we actually got some progress and some parts made, but never far enough to actually make it work. But the idea would be to have a little strain gauge or some sensor on the hand lever so that as you try to engage the brakes, it tries to satisfy your braking request, which may only be slight deceleration, by pulling power out of the wheel. And then if you keep squeezing, like it's a panic stop or you can't sink enough power, then the hydraulics would still kick in. So that's definitely feasible, but it never got finished on this. I do have an electric bicycle right now, which is pretty fun. It's called the Chargers from AeroVironment, the guys who did the Pathfinder and the Helios and all those brilliant things down there.
Does not regenerate.
But the user interface is brilliant. It's the most usable electric bike I can imagine because there's no controls on the handlebars at all other than just normal bike stuff. But what it does is there's a strain gauge that looks at your pedaling effort. It sees how much tension is on the chain, and then it multiplies by a factor that you've keyed in and adds that with its own motor in another chain. So you just feel strong. It's a 70-pound bicycle, and it feels like an ultralight carbon frame, and you feel about 20 years younger. It's depressing, actually. Oh, yes, but see, the key part of that is that if that failed to satisfy your braking request, it still engaged the hydraulics. I would not change the existing brakes. I would only add a sensor that would say, well, he's starting to put on the brakes. Can I satisfy that need electronically? And if that failed, it wouldn't matter because the other brakes would still be there. Yeah, definitely not. Yeah. Ooh. In fact, it's the same thing on the boat. There's things on the boat that, I mean, good grief. I don't trust computers with my life, you know. Well, I guess I do all the time, but there are things on the boat which are not connected to the network. The marine VHF radio has a switch and two wires that go to the battery and its own antenna, and no cross points. It's got a speaker, you know. The nav lights are a switch, et cetera. And in fact, the sail controls, which is, you know, these strings that go up to the sail, those are not controlled by gear motors and things like that. So the things that are basically life and death survival things are all still really mechanical and dead simple. Yeah, actually, the worst one was nearing Abilene, Texas, during that horrible July, and the road was black asphalt, and I was leaving a groove in the pavement. Stuff was so hot, it was like I could actually see my track, and this asphalt was the sludge building up in the fork crown, and you know, just the combination of nasty stuff here caused the front tire to pop, and you know, I was just wearing shorts, and I get off to try to work on this, and there's no place to sit down. You know, it's like the pavement was too hot, all the stuff off the side of the road was all prickly and hot, and that's probably the most unpleasant tire-changing experience I've ever had. So I got in Abilene and drank multiple pitchers of water and Coke at a Pizza Hut, as I recall. So, yeah. Oh, yes, that ran two things. One is the air horns, which I don't know if you can see from there, there's two little aftermarket auto-type horns here. The other was the pneumatic cylinder. It's a double-acting cylinder that drove a four-bar linkage that extended and retracted the landing gear. So, you know, that's why not. No, it's not nitrous, for those of you who care. Yeah?
My question has to do with any sort of interface between your body and the bike in terms of monitoring your heart rate.
I didn't. That was another one of those. That was one of those would-be nice things that we never actually got done. And interestingly, we may be doing a little bit of that on the boat, even though the boat is less biologically intensive. But we just got a sponsorship offer from a telemedicine group that supports expeditions and long-distance sailors and so on. And we might be doing some, you know, VO2 max and other kinds of sensors and that sort of thing. I should mention one other thing about the packaging, by the way. This keeps popping up into my head and then fading away. A lot of what makes all of this work is some way of wrapping it all up in something. And you know, the boat is all fiberglass, and I'll show you that when we get over to the reception. On the bike here, and I have to credit my old pal David Bergstresser over here. I was moaning to him about this packaging problem. I was like, oh, yeah, mumble. How do I build these boxes? And he goes, oh, make it out of cardboard. I did a kayak out of cardboard once. I went, what? Well, we took a stack of cardboard boxes, a hot glue gun, built a structure that looked really nice, and then fiberglassed it. So that's what you're looking at here. This is what we call CSPC, or cellulose core silicon matrix polyester-filled composite. All this stuff and all this stuff is old cardboard boxes. It was just sort of picked up here and there and then covered with fiberglass and polyester resin. So it's a real cheap way to make arbitrary, strangely shaped enclosures. No. The laws of aerodynamics are inflexible and the ground is hard. it's sort of the obvious extrapolation is one-dimensional roads to two-dimensional water surface to three-dimensional air and then maybe four-dimensional time, because by then I'll be really old and we'll need it. I don't know. I'm almost afraid to let myself fall in love with that whole world. I mean, I've been to the EAA and Oshkosh and kind of hung around a lot of home-built airplane people and played with ultralights a little bit. I've never flown, but I mean, I've seen them. And it's really seductive stuff, and I'm sort of afraid to get excited about it because I've been trying to disprove the old notion that the average completion time of a home-built boat is 137 years. And I want to get to the point where I can actually get some time on the water. So maybe. I don't know. But it's all going to be passion-driven, whatever it is. I mean, if at some point that's all I can think about, then I guess I'll do it. Yeah. And yes?
Do you think you could do this on a rollerblade?
I don't know. Try it. Well, actually, since all of these kinds of adventures are things that are made out of your favorite combination of passions, then I think you should put that on your to-do list and give it a try. Actually, to be less flip, the answer is yes. Because the technology you actually need to be mobily connected adequately and have enough power to actually do all the things you really need to do is all backpackable now. You definitely do not need this much junk. And a backpack you could carry on a rollerblade, so why not? Yeah.
How hard is it?
Oh, yeah. You don't want to know. It's not that bad. These landing gear could be sort of propped up on bricks or something, and it becomes a service stand for the rear wheel, which is pain but doable. And the front wheel, I would drop the wheel and sort of prop the front up on a curb or something. You know, there's not always curbs available, but in principle, you can do that. And then I carried a little camp stool, which could support either side of the trailer. One of the bad things about this is that there are three different flavors of tires and tubes, so I had to have multiple spares. Another thing I would do differently today. So, let's see. Any more? How's our timing? When do you want to... Okay, well... So I guess the next thing, and I hope everybody comes with us because the new toy is over at the reception area, and one of the reasons I want to get over there is we have a daylight issue. And I'd love to give you a tour of the boat and go from there. So
we'll
thanks a lot.
Thanks. Thank you.
Thanks.
I really hope everyone really remembers this day because this is the day Behemoth found a new home.
This is a big
thanks
day.
Thanks a million. This is just a thank small you. Token of our appreciation.
Oh, thank you.
For you and to Reed and you and Natasha when you're on your microchips.
Thank you, John.
Thank you. And join us all at the Computer History Museum, Building 126. I think you've got maps. Alexis, you've given those out to folks. We'll have a drawing for one of Steve's books. And Steve's books, by the way, are also on sale out at the desk as he came in.
Yeah, I just got to tell you, as a geek who's been around the computer industry for a long time, I just got a tour of the computer industry the Computer History Center today, and it was absolutely stunning. There's stuff over there that will just it'll take you back. There's things that are amazing that you never knew existed. It's really worth seeing. It's very cool.
And so. You're gonna ride the
yeah, yeah, I think so.
Okay, so Steve's gonna ride it. Thanks again.
Okay, thank you.